Assalamu alaikum dear students. Welcome to Phineas again. Today's topic of our discussion is risk and return. And in this topic we'll discuss the two parts. Here, this topic is divided into two parts. The first part is related with the analysis of a single asset or a single security, and the second part is related with the analysis of portfolio. So what is a single asset or a single security? Single asset means when you will invest 100% of your money in a single asset. For example, you have invested everything in a share of a company, or you have invested everything in a bond of a company, means 100% investment, or you have invested whatever you had in the real estate. This is called a single security, or in single asset, where you are investing 100% in a single security or in a single asset. Whereas a portfolio analysis means when you invest in different securities. For example, you have invested 20% in shares, 30% in bonds, and 50% in, for example, real estate. So in today's video lecture, we'll discuss this first part, and in the second video lecture, in the part 2, we'll discuss the portfolio analysis. But before we move forward, kindly subscribe to my channel Phineas and press the bell icon for future videos notification. So let's start today's discussion with single asset analysis or single stock analysis. What is a single asset or a single stock? As we know that single asset or a single security means we are investing everything in one asset. So let's discuss the return of a single asset. Do remember, this risk and return are two key determinants that finance manager needs to analyze or needs to understand to identify the value of a common stock or identify the value of a security, as well as the value of its firm or its organization. So what is the return? Return means the earnings of an individual. Earnings of an individual, and we can calculate two types of returns. The first return over here is called the holding period return. Holding period return, holding period. Whereas the second period or the second return is called the expected return. Expected return. Achha, do remember, I'll be using alphabet K for return. And this alphabet K in my course is return K. But because we are trying to calculate the holding period return, so I'll use the alphabet H with it. So this is holding period return. So H stands for holding period and K stands for the return, the holding period return. And we can calculate two types of holding period return. So holding period returns ki two types are, we can calculate holding period return in dollar or in amount, and the second is the holding period return in percentage. So what does this holding period return in dollar and holding period return in percentage mean? So let's discuss this. So how to calculate this holding period return? As we know that return means the earnings. So holding period return, this again K is a return and H is the holding period return. But now I'm trying to calculate holding period return in dollars. Holding period return in dollars is calculated like this. Amount received, I'm writing the abbreviation. This A stands for amount and R stands for received. Amount received minus amount invested. What is this amount received? Amount received includes two important things. One is the selling price of the stock. Selling price of the stock, and the second thing it includes is the cash flow that you will receive during the period. Up, what kind of cash flows you can receive? For example, if it's a share, so you can have dividend. But if you have invested in a bond, so instead of dividend, what you will receive? You will receive a coupon payment. So whatever kind of security you are investing, the first thing that it includes in amount received is the selling price, and the second thing that it will have is a cash flow, which means an amount received during the period. And what is this amount invested? Amount invested means the buying price of the security. Buying price of the security. So the formula for holding period return in dollar is amount received means the selling price plus the cash flow that you will receive during the period minus the amount invested. But do remember, whenever you will calculate amount, your return in percentage, so you need to have two additional information, and these two additional information are called the size of the investment, and the second additional information that you need is the timing of the return, means when you will get your return. Because if you don't have these two information, and if you take decision without these two information, then your decisions will be considered as incorrect, or maybe you will not be able to take the appropriate decisions. So what are these two issues? These are called the issues with the return in dollars. So these two issues are size and timing. So let me explain these two issues with an example. For example, we have two options. This is option number one and this is option number two, two investment alternatives. This first option is saying that we can have a return of $100, and this option number two is saying, or it's giving us a return of $1,000. So if I'll ask you which option you need to opt, so as a student, what you will say? You will say, sir, we'll go with this option. Why? Because this is giving us a higher return than this. Means we can have $1,000 return instead of $100 return. So $1,000 return is obviously greater than this $100 return, so we'll go with this. But do remember this. What I said, whenever we'll calculate return in dollars, this is return in dollars. So we need to have these two additional information, size and the timing of the return. Because if we don't have these two information, then the decision taken based on this dollar return will be considered as inappropriate or incomplete. So let me add these two information or these two factors in this information. So let's add the size information. Size means amount of investment, how much I need to invest. So let's assume to have this $100 return, I need to invest $100, and to have this $1,000 return, I need to invest $100,000. So now if I'll ask you which option is beneficial or which option is better, so you'll say, sir, we should go with this option. Why? Because if I'll invest $100, I can have a return of $100. Whereas if you'll invest $100,000, then you'll be able to get ₹1,000 return, your $1,000 return. So as a rational individual, you will select this option. So see, by adding this size of the return information, what we have done, we have changed our decision. So now let me add this second information, which is the timing. Timing of the investment means when I'll be getting my return. So let's see. Yeah, let's assume I'll get this $100 return by investing $100 in 100 years. Means I'll have this return after 100 years. But to have this $1,000 return in 100 by investing $100,000, I'll be needing 1 year. So now if I'll ask you, okay, which option is beneficial, so what you will say? You will say, sir, now this option is feasible. Because we can wait 1 year to have this $1,000 return, but in this case, we need to wait 100 years to have this $100 return. So now, see this. If I'll summarize, so what I said, whenever you will calculate return in dollars, so you need to face two issues. Then you need to have two additional information. One is the size of the return, means how much you need to invest, and the second is timing of the return, means when you'll be getting your returns. If you don't have these two information, then your decisions will be incomplete or will not be considered robust. Why? Because by adding these information, our decision might change or might vary. So what we need to do in this situation? So so to overcome this problem, what we need to do, instead of calculating return in rupees, yeah, in dollars, yeah, in amount, what we need to do, we need to calculate return in percentage. So we can calculate return in percentage, and if we'll calculate the return in percentage, so we'll not have these two issues. So let me tell you the formula how to calculate return in percentage. The formula is amount received minus amount invested divided by amount invested. The same formula, but now we'll have amount invested in the denominator. So let me prove if I'll calculate this return in percentage, then I'll not be able to have these two information. Yeah, I'll not face the issue of timing and size of the return. So let's assume again I have two options, option one and option two. But now option 1 is saying that I can give you 10% return, and option B is saying that we can have a 13% return from option B or second option. So now, if I'll ask you which option you will opt, so you will say, sir, this option is better than this because this is greater than this. Means option B is paying us greater return than option A. So we'll say, okay, as a rational individual, we'll go with option number 2. Now see this, agar aapne decision based on this information, you have taken the decision based on this information, your decision will be considered correct or robust. Why? Because if I add these two information, it will not affect my decision making. Let's add this size information, size of investment. Of what this size has to do, size has nothing to do with this 10%. For example, if I invest $100, I can have 10% of $100. But if I invest $1,000, so I can have 10% of $1,000. But I have to invest $100,000. So I'll add $100,000, still I'll get the 10% of $100,000. Now come to this side. Over here, if I'll invest $100, I'll get 13% of $100. If I'll invest $1,000, so I'll get 13% of $1,000. And if I'll make it $100,000, so $100,000 is 13%. So see, whether I'm investing $100,000 in situation A or in situation B, my percentage of return is not changing. And my decision is also not changing. I am still going with this decision, which is option number B or option number 2, which is giving me 13% return, which is higher than option number 1. Now see, now let's add this timing of the return. As a finance individual, yeah, as a finance student, we know that we always calculate returns on annualized basis. Yeah, we are supposed to consider our returns as annualized, yeah, percentages as annualized. Yeah, we need to convert our percentages into annualized return. For example, you'll go to a bank and you will ask them, okay, I want to an open account. So they'll say, sir, 12% return. So what does 12% means? Means the annual return is 12%. But if they'll say compounded semi-annually, which means the annual rate is 12%, but on after 6 months, yeah, after every 6 months, you'll get half of this. Means 6% in the first half and 6% in the second half. Again, you go to a bank manager and he says that we can give you 12% return, but the compounded quarterly basis. So now what this means? This means 2.5% in the first quarter, 2.5% in the second quarter, 2.5% in the third quarter, and 2.5% in the last quarter, which will be equal to 12% in a year. So rates, yeah, returns are always given on annual basis, yeah, on annualized basis. So let's assume over here the return is 10%. So this 10% is what? This is an annualized return or annualized rate. Compounded, semi-annually, quarterly, or daily basis or weekly basis, it will not make any difference to our life because the rate is always an annualized rate. In this case, it is also an annualized rate. Now, if you'll keep your investment for 1 day, so what you'll do? You'll divide this rate by 365 to get the 1 day rate, and you'll say, I'll get whatever the percentage you'll get by dividing this by 365 into 100,000. So you'll be able to know, okay, what I'll be earning per day. Now, let's assume if you want to invest at for a month, so what you'll do, you'll divide this by 12 months, so you'll get the monthly rate into this amount, so you'll get the monthly return. Similarly, over here, agar aap isko bhi, if you want to invest this in for 1 day, so what you'll do, you'll divide this by 365 or 360, again, whatever rate you'll get, you'll multiply that rate by 100,000. Yeah, for example, you'll invest this, yeah, you want to invest this for 1 month, so again, 13 divided by 12, then you'll get the monthly rate and into this. So still, this will give you the better return. If you'll divide this by 12 and divide this by 12, if you are trying to get a monthly return, so this percentage will be greater, which means this option will give you the higher return. So see, if you'll calculate return in percentage, so then you don't need this information. Agar ye information given nahi bhi hoti, for example, this information is not available, still we can take our decision. But if you are trying to calculate return in rupees ya in dollars, or ab agar if it's saying that you will get $100 return, and in this case it's saying $1,000 return, so now you need the additional information. That is, how much I need to invest to get this $100 return? Yeah, how much I need to invest to get this $1,000 return? And the second thing, for how long I need to wait to get this $100 return and this $1,000 return? I hope this is clear. This is what? Return in percentage and return in rupees. First, we'll discuss the theory related to this, and then we'll discuss the questions related to this topic. So this is the theory related to return of a single stock, and return of a single stock may, at this point, what we have discussed just one concept, which is the holding period return or the periodic return. Now let's try to solve few questions related to this topic, then we'll move to the second part of this, which is the expected return of a single stock. So what is, yeah, how to calculate the return or the holding period return of a single stock? I hope you all have this handout, and if you don't have this handout, I'll save these questions in the description below of my video. So the first question says, if I read this first question for you guys, so this says, you purchase a zero coupon bond. As a finance student, I hope you know what is a zero coupon bond. Zero coupon bond, if you don't know what is a zero coupon bond, so let me explain what is a zero coupon bond. Zero coupon bond means a bond which will not pay you any periodic payment. If I'll draw a cash flow timeline for you guys, so this is year 0, 1, 2, 3, for example, 20 years. The life of this bond is 20 years. You have invested $1,000 and this bond has promised to pay you 10% return, which is your coupon payments. Capital I like capital I for coupon payments, which means $100 in the first year, in the second year, and it will continue till the date of maturity. And at the time of maturity, you'll get your principal amount as well. This is what? This is a normal bond. But when we say a zero coupon bond means it will not pay you any coupon payments. You will not get these amounts. This is a zero. So what you will have? You will have just the principal amount. So what you need to do? Yeah, how to calculate the value of a bond? To, for the formula to calculate the value of the bond is, because this is the present, you need to कैलकुलेट द प्रेजेंट वैल्यूज ऑफ दीज फ्यूचर कैश फ्लोज. आपको इनकी प्रेजेंट वैल्यूज कैलकुलेट करनी पड़ती है. एंड व्हाट्स द फॉर्मूला, बिकॉज दिस इज अ सीरीज ऑफ कैश फ्लोज, सो यू कैन यूज एन एन्युटी फॉर्मूला, एंड फॉर दिस यू कैन नीड और यू नीड अ सिंगल सम फॉर्मूला. एंड इफ यू हैव स्टडीड द बॉन्ड वैल्यूएशन टॉपिक तो यू नो हाउ टू कैलकुलेट दिस. लेकिन बिकॉज इट्स अ जीरो कूपन बॉन्ड तो इट विल हैव ओनली अ कूपन वैल्यू, ओ इट विल ओनली हैव अ पार वैल्यू. तो नाउ हाउ टू कैलकुलेट द प्रेजेंट वैल्यू ऑफ द पार वैल्यू विच विल बी गेटिंग एट द टाइम ऑफ मेच्योरिटी. तो नाउ वॉट आई नीड टू कैलकुलेट, आई नीड टू कैलकुलेट द प्रेजेंट वैल्यू और द वैल्यू ऑफ द बॉन्ड. प्रेजेंट वैल्यू और वी बी, वी बी स्टैंड फॉर द प्रेजेंट वैल्यू ऑफ द बॉन्ड. तो वी बी ऑफ अ बॉन्ड इज इक्वल टू वॉट आई नीड, आई नीड द पार वैल्यू मीन्स द प्रिंसिपल अमाउंट वन प्लस के डी. के डी इज माई कॉस्ट ऑफ डेट. वी हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस इन द लास्ट फ्यू लेक्चर्स दैट वॉट इज के डी. इन द इफ यू हैव स्टडीड बॉन्ड वैल्यूएशन टॉपिक तो यू नो वॉट इज के डी. के डी माइनस एन, एन इज नंबर ऑफ ईयर्स और नंबर ऑफ पीरियड्स. तो नाउ सी दिस हाउ टू कैलकुलेट द वैल्यू ऑफ अ बॉन्ड. इट सेज यू हैव परचेज अ जीरो कूपन बॉन्ड बाय पेइंग द प्राइस ऑफ $152. वॉट इज दिस $152? दिस इज द बाइंग प्राइस. तो आई विल से बाइंग प्राइस is $152.37. This is my buying price. Then it says having the par value of 1000, my par value is $1000. The rate of interest or the market interest rate is 10%. Market interest rate means this KD. KD is 10%. Then it says if the bond has 20 years to maturity, N is equals to 20 years. Now the most important line, when you originally purchased it, what was your total return at the end of the last year? You purchased this bond 1 year ago and at that time the life was 20 years. But now the 1 year has passed, so it means now the remaining life is, what you'll do, you'll subtract 1 year because 1 year has passed. So now the remaining life is 19 years. So now what I need to know the value of or the current value of the bond. So what is the current value of the bond? So my par value is 1000, I'll write 1000 over here. What's my KD? My KD is 10%, so I'll say 1 plus 0.1 minus, what's my value of N? So now the my value of N is 19 years. So this is 1000 is my par value and this is my discount factor over 19 years. So if I'll solve this, I'll get the value is $163.51. This is the VB of the bond, means the current price of the bond, means I can sell my bond at this price. So I'll say this is my selling price. This is what? This is my selling price of the bond. Selling price. So now if I'll try to calculate the return of a single stock or return of a bond, what I need? I need the formula of return of a single stock. The formula is, let me erase this first and let me write the formula. So return in dollars is equals to amount received minus amount invested. What is my amount received? So this is my selling price. So I'll say 163.51. And we have read the question, and in the question it's not saying that you have received any other cash flow during the period. So this is what 163.51 will be considered as, the total amount received minus what's my buying price. So I purchased this stock in $152.37. This is $163 and this is $152. So now if I'll subtract this, so I'll get the answer, which is $11.14, I guess. This is what? This is your return or the holding period return in rupees or in dollars or in amount. Now, if I'll try to calculate the return in percentage, so what I need to do, return in percentage, K percentage is equals to amount received minus amount invested divided by amount invested. So what's my amount received? 163.51 minus 152.37 divided by 152.37. So we'll get what? We'll get the answer, which will be 0.0731. Because it's a rate or it's a percentage, so we'll say this is 7.31%. Technically what we are doing, we are multiplying this by 100 to convert this into percentage. So my K percentage or the holding period return in percentage is 7.31. What this 7.31 is representing? This 7.31 is saying that on annual basis, we are getting 7.31% return from this bond. So now if I have invested $100,000, so I'll say $100,000 into 7.1%, 7.31%. If I have invested $100, so I'll say $100 into 7.31% if I'm trying to calculate the return. So this is my annual return or annualized return, which is 7.31. This is question number one of this handout. Now let's solve question number two of this handout. So question number two is, it says you bought a share. So see, this question was related with the bond. So if you have studied bond valuation, you know how to calculate the present value of the bond. Now the second question is related with shares. Let me erase this. Okay, ji. So question number two says you bought a share of 6% preferred stock. See, this is not a common stock. This is a preferred stock. So see, this means it's a special kind of stock. Preferred stock. And you purchase this stock by paying $84.2. So preferred stock. Buying price of preferred stock is what? $84.12. The market price of the stock is 80.27. Means the selling price of preferred stock is 80.27. What is the selling price? Selling price means the value of a preferred stock, VPS. We call it VPS. Valuation mein, we call it VPS. Then it says preferred stock has paid you a dividend of $5. Dividend of $5. So this is called DPS. D stands for dividend and P stands for preferred stock. So dividend of $5. Now it says what is your return for the last year? Last year ka return calculate karna. So again, if I'll try to calculate return in dollars, in rupees, so I'll say selling price or the amount received. So amount received, I'll say 80.27. This is what I have received by selling my stock, plus I've received a dividend of $5 during this period. So this is my amount received minus what's my amount invested? $84.12. So if I'll subtract this, I'll get the answer, which will be $1.15. This is what return in dollars for a preferred stock. So I'll earn a dollar. Yeah, I've earned a return of $1.15 during the year. Now if I'll try to convert this into percentage, so I'll say K percentage is equals to, again, same formula, amount received minus amount invested, divide by amount invested. So where is my amount received? My amount received is 85.27. Why I'm saying 85? Because 80.27 plus this 5 is 85.27 minus what's my amount invested? So amount invested is 84.12 divided by 84.12. So this will give me a return of 0.0137, which is equals to what? 13.7%. Again, it's a rate. So what I have done, I have written this in percentage. What I've done, technically I've multiplied this by 100. So this is question number 2 or the solution of question number 2. Again, I'll be copying these questions in the description of this video so you can check what are the questions and these are the solutions of these questions. And my students know from where to get these questions because I've shared this the question handout with them. Now, question number 3 of this handout. What is question number 3? Question number 3 is related with a common stock. So question number 1 is related with bond. Question number 2 is related with preferred stock and question number 3 is related with a common stock. So let me discuss or let me solve question number 3. Question number 3 says you bought a stock 3 months ago. Means the buying price of the stock is dollar shares. You have purchased a share, buying of a common share. And you have paid what? $38.65 per share. The company has paid a dividend of 0. Dividend is 0, no dividend. The current share price is 42, which means VS, value of the stock, or selling price is $42.02. Now it's asking us to calculate the return. So now if I'll try to calculate return, so return again in, again, the return in dollars is equals to what? I'll say this is my amount received, 42.02. I've not received any dividend, so I'll not add any cash flow in this selling price. Minus my buying price is $38.65. So if I'll subtract this, so I'll get the answer, which will be $3.37. This is what return in percentage. This is the answer of question number 3. What we have done, we have calculated the return in percentage. The weather is very hot these days. This is question number 3. Now, question number 3 mein, what we are trying to calculate? We are trying to calculate the percentage. So what we need? We need 3.37, which is the difference between these two values, divided by 38.65. So this will give us 0.0872, which will be equal to 8.72%. Again, it's a return, or it's a percentage or rate of return. So what I have done, I have multiplied my answer by 100 to convert this into percentage. So this is question number 3. So up till now, what we have discussed the holding period return. And in holding period return, we have discussed two types of holding period returns: return in rupees, yeah, in dollars. And the second is return in percentage. And we said whenever we'll calculate return in amount, yeah, in dollars, yeah, in rupees, so we need to have two additional information, or we'll have two issues. One is the size of the return, means how much we need to invest. And the second thing is what will be the timing of the return, means when I'll be getting my returns. So just to overcome these two issues, what we need to do, we'll calculate, yeah, we'll always calculate return in percentage. So this 8.72 is explaining what? This 8.72 is explaining, okay, I'll be getting 8.72%. If this is a quarterly return, so I can convert this into annualized return, because it's a 3 months return. So I'll say my annualized return is 8.72 multiplied by 4. So I'll get an annualized return, which means whatever that percentage is, I'll get on annual basis, and it will not be dependent on the amount or the size of the investment. Chalo. Now let's move to the second part. The second part of this topic is, second part in terms of risk and return is the return of a single stock, but now it's not an holding period return, it's an expected return of a single stock. So do remember, now we are discussing expected return. There are many other kinds of returns which we will not be discussing in today's topic, but in the upcoming classes maybe we'll be discussing the geometric return, harmonic return, and the average return, and other different kinds of returns. So what is an expected return? For expected return, again I'll be using the alphabet K, but now I'll use this head sign over K. This is called K hat. What is this K hat? K hat is representing expected return of a single stock. Expected return. This is what? This is my expected return of a single stock. Do remember, expected return is based on the forecasted value. So it means you'll be needing the probabilities of different situations. In other words, to calculate the expected return of a single stock, you need to have different situations returns, and you need to have the probability of those different situations. So what is an expected return of a single stock? The expected return of a single stock is called the weighted average of all possible returns multiplied by their respective probabilities. And over here, we'll consider these probabilities as their weights. So the formula for expected return of a single stock will look like this. K hat of a single stock is equals to K of first situation, means first situation return, into probability of that situation, plus expected return of return of the second situation multiplied by probability of second situation, and it will continue till probability of KI and return of KI. I it represents the individual stock. So what's the formula? If I'll summarize this, so I'll say this is summation KI into PI. Summation KI into PI. What does summation KI into PI is representing? Summation KI into PI is representing that individual stocks, they are different situations returns into probabilities of different situations. This is situation 1, situation 2, and then so on and so forth. So till I situation or till N situation, we can have the returns and their probabilities. But do remember, we all know that the sum of all probabilities, sum of probabilities should be equal to 1. So if the probability of few stocks are given and few stocks are missing, so we can easily identify, one stock is missing, so we can easily identify by subtracting the given probabilities from 1 to calculate the probability of the missing stock. So now let's solve the expected return of an individual stock. So again, this handout, now I'm discussing question number 4. For my students, this is question number 8, but for those students who are watching this video and they don't have this handout, for them this is question number 4. Question number 4. So I am solving this question number 4. But first, let me write the data or the information related to question number 4 over here. So what this question number 4 is asking us to calculate. So it says, based on the following information, calculate the expected return. What we need to calculate? Expected return. What's the information? It has given us a table in which it's showing us three situations. Your situation is given over here. The economic conditions are given. It says recession, in the second situation, or the second situation is normal situation, your normal state of the economy, and the third situation is when you have boom in the economy. Now, let's assume we are trying to calculate an expected return of X stock. X stock means any single stock. So now, what's the chances of getting a specific percentage of return during this period? So for this, we need to have the probability. So what's the probability of getting a specific percentage of return? So in this situation, it says it's 0.2. And what's that return? So in this situation, we can have a return of minus 0.05. This is what KI, this is my KI. What is this KI again? KI is the return of an individual situation and PI is the probability of individual situation. So this is situation number 1, which is a recession, and in recession we can have a return of 0.05 negative return, and the chances or the probability of getting this return is 0.2. Now the second situation says you can have a return of 0.12, which means 12%, and the chance or the probability of getting this return is 0.5. And the last situation says that the probability is 0.3 and the return will be 0.25. Now what we need to calculate, we need to calculate the expected return of a single stock. So we know that what is the formula for expected return of a single stock? K hat is equals to summation KI into PI. Yeh formula, we'll be using this formula. So what I can do, I can add one more column over here which will multiply KI into PI. So I'll say KI into PI. Where's my KI? This is my KI. So I'll say this is 0.05 multiply by, where is my probability? This is 0.2. In this situation, my KI is 0.12 multiply by 0.5. And the last situation, it says 0.25 multiply by 0.3. Up, if I'll solve these, so I'll get the values which will be minus 0.01, the first situation. In the second situation, we'll have 0.06, and the third situation says I'll have a return of 0.075. Now, if I'll take the sum of these values, so the sum will be called summation KI into PI, and the sum will be 0.125. This is what? This is my expected return. So I'll say my expected return is equals to 12.5%. So this is the answer of question number 8, and the question number 8 says calculate the expected return of product X, yeah, stock X, and the expected return of stock X is 12.5% as per our calculation. Now let's move to the second part of our discussion, which is the risk of an individual security. Up till now, what we have done, we have discussed the return of the individual security, and in this we have discussed two types of returns. The first one is the holding period return or the periodic return, and the second one is the K hat, which is the expected return. Up till now we have discussed these two things. Now what we are trying to discuss, we are trying to discuss the risk. So let's discuss the risk. So risk is what? Risk is what? Risk means uncertainty or unpredictability or vulnerability between what? Between your actual outcome and the expected outcome. Means this uncertainty between the actual and the expected outcome is called a risk. Yeah, volatility. For example, in any course, yeah, in my course, students are expecting 70% marks. So this 70% marks is what? This is your expectation. But when you will get your final result, so there is a possibility you will score more than 70 marks or less than 70 marks. So this uncertainty between your actual and the expected outcome is your risk. Yeah, nobody in this world can guarantee you at this point of time that you will be getting 70% marks in my course. Yeah, for example, your expectation from a security is 15% return. But nobody can guarantee you that you will be getting exactly 15% return. There is a possibility you will get more than 15% return or less than 15% return. So this uncertainty between your actual and expected outcome is called risk. And in finance, the statistical tool that we use to measure the risk is called a variance or a standard deviation. So what is a variance here? What is a standard deviation? Variance or standard deviation will tell us the dispersion or scattering of the data around the expected values or in the mean values. If you are talking about the mean returns, so the dispersion or scattering of the data around the mean values. And if you are talking about the expected returns, so we are saying that the dispersion or scattering of the data around the expected values, the expected outcome. For example, these are your outcomes. This is your, this line is your expected outcome, your mean value, and the scattering of data is called the dispersion or scattering of data around the mean values or the expected outcome is your standard deviation or variance. So to calculate major or to measure risk in finance, we need to calculate the variance or standard deviation. For variance, the symbol is sigma square, and for standard deviation we use sigma. This is called sigma, S-I-G-M-A, sigma. The symbol is called sigma. So over here we'll be using sigma to represent standard deviation, and we'll be using sigma square to discuss the variance or to calculate variance. So let's calculate variance or sigma of a single stock. So what's the formula of sigma or the variance of a single stock? So the formula is variance of a single stock is equals to summation ki minus k hat whole square into pi. What is this ki? Again, this ki is the individual situation's return. What is this k hat? So we know what is k hat. K hat is the expected return of an individual security, which means to calculate this sigma, we need to calculate the expected return of an individual security. Plus, we need to have the probability of individual situation. So what it will do, we'll subtract the individual situation return into the expected return of that security. Then we'll take the square of that value and then we'll multiply by its probability. And once we'll solve this, we'll take the summation to calculate the sigma square. And if we'll try to calculate the sigma, which is standard deviation, so what we'll do, we'll take the under root of this. Summation ki minus k hat ka whole square into pi. This is what? This is the sigma, means the standard deviation of a single stock. Now let's solve question number 9. For my students, this is question number 9. And for those students who are using the questions given in the description of this video, for them, it's question number 5. So let's solve this question number 5. In question number 5, or question number 9, we have information of two securities. There are two securities. Yeah, two stocks. The first stock is stock A, and the second one is stock B. So first I'll solve the information related with stock A, and then we'll solve for stock B. So stock A, now what it's asking us to calculate? It's asking us to calculate the expected return and the standard deviation of two stocks. Expected return and standard deviation of two stocks. So let me solve the expected return and standard deviation of the two stocks. Again, three situations where three states of economies are given. Recession. Then it says normal. And then the last one is the boom situation. This is what? Economic conditions. Condition. This is question number 4. No, sorry, this is question number 5. Okay, then what else is given? It says that the probability, means the PIs of different situation, is 0.1, 0.6, and this will be 0.3, because the sum of all probabilities should be equal to 1. Then it says the return or the expected, sorry, return of individual situation of stock A for stock A is 0.06. Then it says 0.07, and then it says 0.11. So now if I'll try to calculate the expected return of an individual stock, so what I need to do, I'll say summation, sorry, KI into PI. So where is my KI? This is my KI, 0.06 multiplied by PI, which is 0.1. Then it says 0.07 multiplied by 0.6. And in this, it says 0.11 multiplied by 0.3. So if I'll multiply 0.06 by 0.01, so I'll get 0.006. And in the second situation, I'll get 0.042. And in the last situation, I'll get 0.033. This is what? These are KIs into PIs. So it means the K head of an individual asset or stock A will be 0.081, which means 8.1%. Now let's calculate the standard deviation or the variance of the stocks or this stock. So what we need? We need KI minus K hat a whole square into PI. Where's my KI? So this is my KI. So I'll write 0.06 minus 0.081 a whole square multiplied by my probability. Where's my probability? So my probability is 0.1 for the first situation. Then in the second situation, I'll say, what's my KI? 0.07 minus 0.081 ka whole square multiplied by 0.6. The last one is 0.11 minus 0.081 ka whole square multiplied by 0.3. Now if I'll solve this, so I'll get the following values. The first value is, let me copy these values from this handout. The first value will be 0.000441. The second value will be 0.1234726. And the last value will be 0.0002523. Now if I'll take the sum, so this sum will be called summation KI minus K hat ka whole square into PI, which will be equal to 0.000369. What does 0.00369? This is my variance. This is my sigma square. Now if I'll try to take the or calculate the value of sigma, so sigma will be 1.92%. How I have calculated this? By taking the under root of this value. So I'll be able to calculate the sigma of this stock. Okay, now let's move to the second stock. Now what I'll do, I'll not calculate each and every value. I'll just tell you the values of K hat and the sigma square, because I have to tell you the last concept, which is the coefficient of variation in the single stock. So now for stock B, this is stock B. I'll have K hat of stock B is equals to, the answer will be 15.70, and the sigma of this stock B, sigma of stock B will be equal to 14.89. So this is stock B, and for stock A, we have already calculated the information. For stock A, the expected return of stock A is equals to 8.10%, and the sigma for stock A is 1.92%. This is what sigma of stock A. So this is for stock A, and this information is related with stock B. So up till now, what we have done, we have discussed the expected return of a single stock and the sigma or the risk of a single stock. Now the last concept, that is the coefficient of variation, CV. We call it CV, that is coefficient of variation. What is this coefficient of variation? Coefficient of variation will tell you the per unit risk. What do we mean by per unit risk? Do you remember, whenever we'll take decision based on the return, if you're trying to take decisions based on return, let's assume this is my return and I have three stocks A, B and C. If you're trying to take your decision based on returns, so you will say I'll always select a security with higher return. So what you will do, you will say B is paying me the highest return among the three stocks, so I'll go with B. Means in terms of return, we'll always select a security with highest return. But if I'm trying to take decision based on risk, so in terms of risk, you'll always opt a security with the lowest risk, 1.3%, and this is 1 point will be 2.5%. Let's assume this is 1.25%. So I'll say this stock A is better stock because it has the lowest risk. So if you have faced this kind of situation where you can't take decision based on the risk and you can't take decision based on the return of the security, because in terms of return, the B is giving us the highest return, but in terms of risk, security A has the lowest risk. So now what we need to do? We need to calculate the coefficient of variation. Why? Because coefficient of variation will tell us the per unit risk. So when to use this coefficient of variation? We will use this coefficient of variation when we will not be able to take decision based on the return or the risk of the security. So the formula of coefficient of variation is sigma over k hat. Sigma means the risk. Where is the risk? So these are the risk. And where is the return? So these are the returns of the individual stocks. So let me try to calculate the risk and return of these two stocks. This is question number 5. So in question number 5, the requirement does not ask you to calculate this coefficient of variation. But let's assume if the requirement asks you to calculate the coefficient of variation, if it's asking you to take your decision, so what you'll do, you'll take the coefficient of, or you'll calculate the coefficient of variation. The coefficient of variation for stock A will be 0.0192 divided by 0.081. And for B, coefficient of variation of B will be, where's my sigma? This is my sigma, 0.01489 divided by my return of 0.1570. Sorry, this is 0.1489. So now if I'll divide this, so I'll get two values. What's the coefficient of variation for stock A? So coefficient of variation for stock A is 0.237, and for stock B, the coefficient of variation is 0.948. So now we'll say that the stock A is less risky than stock B. Yeah, this stock A is giving us less risk per unit than stock B. Do remember, higher the coefficient, higher the risk. Yeah, higher the coefficient means the higher the per unit risk. So based on the coefficient of variation, we'll always select a security with the lowest value of coefficient of variation. So in this situation, I'll say the stock A is giving us a better return, or stock A will give us, or it's a better option for investment. So up till now, what we have discussed the single stock's returns, which is a holding period return and a expected return. And then we discussed the risk of a single stock, in which we calculated the sigma or the sigma squares of the individual stocks. And in the end, what we have done, we have discussed the coefficient of variation. What is coefficient of variation? Coefficient of variation means the per unit risk. And we have solved few questions related to single stock risk and return analysis and the coefficient of variation. In the next video, we'll discuss the portfolio analysis. If you have any query, you can write in the comment section below. I'll try my level best to answer your queries. Otherwise, from my side, that's it. Thank you for today's lecture. Take care.